Chesham Cave. Subtitle, How to Read a News Release. Because if you take the release uncritically, without thinking about it, it can have implications that perhaps are damaging and perhaps unnecessarily so. The talk today is taken from an article entitled Scientists Find Signs of Intelligent Tool Use 300,000 Years Ago by Ross Pomeroy in November 30, and it's found at realclearscience.com. This is on the internet, you can look it up. Those of you who get the email should have had the reference given to you. 16 years ago, road workers detonated a controlled explosive to remove a large limestone boulder blocking a planned roadway outside of Tel Aviv in Israel. Soon after the dust settled, it became clear that the road would need to be rerouted. The workers had stumbled upon a vast cave, one that had been sealed off for more than 200,000 years. Now, you know, if you're a creationist, you're reading this and you're thinking, wait a minute, what's going on? For the researchers who soon began exploring the cave's expansive interior, it was the find of a lifetime. Now called Chesham Cave, and in case you're wondering, Chesham is the word for magic, divination in the Bible. Or one of the words. So you could call it Magic Cave. The site has delivered a number of discoveries that live up to its explosive origin. Archaeologists found a 300,000-year-old fireplace, along with tortoise shells that showed signs of burning. Apparently, whoever lived there had a taste for roast tortoise. Sounds like they weren't living by the Levitical laws. Exactly who lived there remained a mystery, however. While archaeologists have uncovered a handful of hominin teeth, they still aren't sure which species they belong to. It could be Homo erectus, Homo neanderthalensis, or it might be even an entirely new species. And if you're looking at the colors, in the original this is red and that's orange, but the blue shows up better. So we don't know what type of human lived here, Ron Barkai, an archaeologist at Tel Aviv University, told Unet News. We know that they acted differently than everyone else who lived in this area before them. Whoever inhabited Chesham many aeons ago, a study recently published in Scientific Reports reveals that they were advanced tool users. A team of archaeologists led by Barkai and his colleagues Avi Gopher and Andrea Zupancic, I believe that is, uncovered two sharpened flint tools pictured above. Well, we're going to picture them in a minute, as well as a deer bone with distinct saw marks pictured below. We'll see that too. The artifacts are between 300,000 and 420,000 years old. Again, you're a creationist, you're going, I'd like a little more information. Here's one of the tools, and you can they've enlarged this somewhere else, not in the press release. And here you can see an edge of a tool which has been somewhat polished person who wrote the article just grabbed some neat-looking pictures and showed them. Here's a deer antler that has been sawed across here. And here are some bones that have been sawed across. While most observers would simply be satisfied with putting two and two together. The researchers wanted to be sure that the tools were actually used on the bones and that the marks didn't simply result from gnawing or butchering. Rigorous examination revealed clear bone residues on the flint tools. See image below. And we're going to look at that. And I want you to pay attention to that because we're going to find out that the picture doesn't really match. The researchers also observed signs that the marks were created after the bone was broken and defleshed. And here's the picture that they show. And there's some little fibers here, and there's some little bone polish there on a flint tool. So probably a flint tool was used on bone. This is D and E. We're going to come back to that. The results of this study allow us to argue that at Kesem Cave, hominins were bringing selected body parts of hunted game to the cave, and after the meat, fat, and marrow were consumed, they occasionally used the discarded animal bones for non-dietary purposes, the researchers write. Tool use dates back at least 2.5 million years, and there's a link to an article that says that, but this may be one of the earliest examples of hominins modifying and utilizing tools for a purpose other than eating or hunting for food. Think about that a little bit, and we'll come back to that maybe at the end in the discussion. The data presented here represented innovative behavior practiced between 420 and 300, boy, they like those numbers, a thousand years ago. Perhaps the oldest evidence related to intentional non-dietary modification of bone through the use of specific stone tools, the researchers say. Coupled with past findings, the present study clearly shows that Kesem Cave was a hub of activity for intelligent hominins. The last and greatest mystery left to be solved is to find out exactly who those hominins were. And there's a source. So you turn to the source, hoping to find a little bit more out, and you do. Before we do that, I want you to notice some comments here. One just says thanks, but then Barbara Piper writes, not to quibble too much, but since tool making by hominins is dated at least a couple million years ago, I'm not sure why it's noteworthy that a community was making and using tools 300,000 years ago. It would be more interesting if there had been no evidence of tool use. Good point. Except that the way the article is read, it doesn't fit well, as you will find out. Ross Pomeroy said, that's a fair quibble. I added a passage acknowledging your point and explaining why the find is still probably noteworthy. That is, these are the first tools that you can prove were, it's not sure exactly what were used for something other than food, it sounds like. So what we have read is actually a corrected version, and they didn't note the correction at the bottom, which is interesting. Press releases modified on the fly without telling you. And then the other thing that's said here is, understood the point of the article is this phrase. The data presented here represents an innovative behavior practiced between 425 and 300 kiloyears, possibly the oldest evidence related to intentional non-dietary modification of bone through the use of specific stone tools. And unfortunately, he obviously doesn't speak English, because is no the use of tools for their uses since around 2.5 million years by hominins. And that's the end of the comments, but I thought it'd be interesting to look at them because they do indicate that what you see is not necessarily what he wrote at the beginning. And there's no notification other than in the comments that that happened. So, you know, if we think, well, we need to redo that, we just kind of slip it in without saying anything. And it isn't quite as impressive. As a matter of fact, we're going to find out that it isn't even that impressive. Why is that important? Because one of the things you need to remember is that press releases are hype. They are an attempt to get you to look at the work, the research. And they don't necessarily, they're not necessarily completely accurate, as we're going to see some more in just a bit. So, let's go back to the original article. University doesn't belong there. Early evidence of stone tool use in bone working activities at Kesem Cave, Israel, by a raft of people. Scientific Reports, 6, Article 37686, and published online the 25th of November, 2016. So just a couple months ago. Matter of fact, a month and a half ago. And there is a, you can get this on the internet as well, interestingly enough. For a long while, the controversy surrounding several bone tools coming from Upper Paleolithic contexts favored the view that of Homo sapiens as the only species of the genus Homo capable of modifying animal bones into specialized tools. I thought Neanderthals produced bone flutes. That seems like an overstatement, but maybe if you're coming from a standard education, it isn't an overstatement, because the company line has always been that. Obviously, it was close enough to the company line that the abstract and the paper got published. So keep that in mind. Sometimes people are dispelling myths that should have been dispelled a long time ago, but haven't in the standard way of looking at things. However, evidence such as South African early Stone Age modified bones, European lower Paleolithic flaked bone tools, along with Middle and Late Pleistocene bone retouchers, led to a reevaluation of the conception of Homo sapiens as the exclusive manufacturer of specialized bone tools. So they assumed that Neanderthals and Denisovans, I believe it is, just didn't make stone bone tools or stone tools or something like that. And as it turns out, that's not correct, which means that those critters were probably human. The evidence presented herein includes wear and bone residues identified on two flint scrapers, as well as a sawing mark on a fallow deer tibia, not associated with butchering activities. Dated to more than 300 kiloyears ago, the evidence here presented is among the earliest related to tool-assisted bone working intended for non-dietary purposes, and contributes to the debate over the recognition of bony working as a much older behavior than previously thought. Okay. So, now the results of this study come from the application of a combined methodological approach comprising use wear analysis, residue analysis, and taphonomy. This approach allowed for the retrieval of both direct and indirect evidence of tool-assisted bone working at the lower Paleolithic site of Kesem Cave, Israel. That's the abstract. I'm not going to read the entire article, obviously, but we're going to go through some of the more salient parts of it. Introduction, Homo sapiens, supposedly exclusive manufacturer of specialized tools. And again, this is getting through the peer-reviewed literature. So obviously, a lot of people had the impression that Homo sapiens was the only tool maker. Made from modified animal bones, along with other aspects such as art and specialized hunting weapons, has led to the definition of a clear behavioral and cognitive boundary between Homo sapiens and the other species of genus Homo. And they have a reference for that. So it's actually in the peer-reviewed literature. but it's wrong. However, numerous evidence, that's an interesting way of phrasing it. Obviously, somebody doesn't speak idiomatic English. Coming from South Africa and Europe, suggests that the exploitation of modified animal bones should be viewed as an expression of a much older behavior. Some of the oldest evidence relating to the use of modified animal bones comes from several early Stone Age South African contexts, and there are five references. Animal bones were used by early hominids for termite foraging at the sites of Swartkens and Sterkfontein, dated between 1.8 and 1 million years ago. So that's two of the references. Analysis of the bone tools found at the site of Djimolin, dated between 2 and 1.5 million years ago, produced similar results. And the rest of the paragraph has some more data of the same general kind. I'm going to omit that. If you're interested, I suggest you read the article. Again, we're going to skip over a paragraph or so. Other examples of tools made from modified animal bones include flake bone tools. And there's some other examples behind that as well. Here we present evidence related to the processing of animal bones unrelated to dietary purposes. How do you know that? And performed using specific actions and specific stone tools. This evidence originates from the Middle Pleistocene site of Kesem Cave in Israel and has not yet been observed in any other context as old as this. The evidence presented here is at least 300,000 years old, possibly closer to 400,000 years old, and is, and there's a reference there, a couple of references there. We're going to go into those because that's where they actually establish how old this stuff is, and is potentially some of the earliest evidence of deliberate stone tool-assisted bone working associated with non-dietary purposes. Now, the results, and I'll just read the entire results because it's right there in one paragraph. The Middle Pleistocene site of Kesem Cave in Israel is dated between 420 and 200,000 years ago and is culturally associated with the late Lower Paleolithic Acheulo-Yabrudian cultural complex. Before you panic, there's just a couple of names for, there's the Acheulean group, and there's the Yabrudian group, and they're named after some sites. And one of them is the Acheulo is older than the Yabrudian. And the standard, you know, dates are between 420 and 200 kilo years. Ongoing research at the cave provides a wealth of well-preserved evidence for innovative behaviors throughout the sequence, including stone tool technology and use, subsistence economy, and site organization, possibly practiced by a new hominin lineage. Whoa, don't we have enough already? So we'll come back to that statement. Now you see this D and E? You may recognize those pictures. Fibers and globular residual concretions packed along the edge of experimental tools used for bone sawing. To be fair, I actually just duplicated it because it's the same picture and I didn't want to go through resizing it. But it's the same. It's that picture, D and E. Along the edge of experimental tools used for bone sawing. These guys made their own tools. They did some sawing on the bone. And the picture you see is stone tools that were made, I don't know, 3 years ago? When you looked at it in the original context, it sounded like that was the stone tools that they found. Now, there are some other pictures that shows a little bit of residual on the old stone tools. But I want you to point out that whoever wrote the article misunderstood what those pictures were for. And it's the same pictures because it has the D and the E and the 200 millimeters and the 500 millimeters. If you go back to it, you'll see that it's the same exact picture. Now, skipping along a little further, thus the most likely explanation in this case is that the observed deep sawing mark is a result of a non-dietary action that occurred after the bone had been defleshed and marrow processed for consumption. So now you can understand what they're talking about. Basically, they took the bone, they carved all the meat off of it, they broke it and they got all the marrow out of it, and then they sawed it after that was done. Now, how do you know that that actually happened? Well, that makes it a little difficult. I'm not sure. And that question should be in your mind while you're trying to figure this all out. But was it used for procuring more food? We don't know. This is somebody that's trying to put a story back that will make their research look better. And maybe if it sounds good enough, they'll get more grant money. So remember, according to Kahn, science is about two things, getting grants and publishing research, right? Well, you'd like to say that your work is influences the ability to get grants and public research.
You got to try and salvage it to significance.
And this is pretty thin gruel. I'm not saying it's worthless, but you know, now that you're starting to see what's going on, you see some tools have been known for a long time to be back further than this in the standard ways of dating things. Okay? So this is grantsmanship. We can state that the Kesem hominins used the bones for a non-nutritional activity. And this fact can be related to the inclusion of new materials in their chain and operator. The data presented here represents an innovative behavior practiced between 420 and 300 kiloyears ago, possibly the oldest evidence related to intentional non-dietary modification of bone through the use of specific stone tools. So they cut the bone after they were all done to do something with it. That's what they mean when they say non-dietary. It was done after there wasn't any more food for that bone, but it doesn't say anything about whether the bone was used for food, was used for something, was used for procuring food, was used for something else. Who knows? Now, going back to that, possibly practiced by a new hominin lineage. Well, they have a reference, and it's on the internet. I'm just going to read a piece of the abstract. Thus, like the previously reported teeth from Kesem Cave, the new dental remains show some features that seem more consistent with the fossils of early Homo sapiens from the sites of Kafsa and Shkul. I think that's how it is. Shkul. And some features which appear to align themselves with Neanderthals. Given the uncertainties regarding the phylogenetic polarity of several of these features, a conclusive taxonomic diagnosis remains elusive and must wait the discovery of additional more complete remains from the site, for which we want more grant money. That sounds like a fancy way of saying we don't really know what's going on. Maybe it's Homo sapiens, maybe it's Homo neanderthalensis, maybe it's some mixture or admixture of something else along with it, we can't really be sure from the teeth. So, yeah, that's kind of a shaky piece of the writing. The evidence presented here is at least 300,000 years old, possibly close to 400,000 years old. Remember that? Well, let's look at 17 first, and Gopher et al., and that is available on ResearchGate, so again, you can get that free. Abstract, we present here the results of a uranium-thorium dating project at Kesem Cave, a middle Pleistocene, later lower Paleolithic site in Israel. And the results indicate that human occupation started sometime between 420 and 320 kiloyears ago and ended between 220 and 194 kiloyears ago. 194, not 193. I'm sure that that should be a rough estimate. A survey of dates from culturally similar sites in the Levant indicates that the general range of about 400 to 200 kiloyears is an appropriate estimate for the lifespan of the Acheuleo-Yabrudian cultural complex, that AYCC that we've seen before. Skipping over, the chronology of the AYCC was discussed by Bar Yosef, Copeland and Mercier and Velatis and so forth. U series, thermoluminescence, and electron spin resonance, available ages, indicate that the earliest dates for the Acheuleo-Yabrudian are circa 400 kiloyears. The end of the AYCC is considered to be 200 kiloyears in references, although early work has indicated dates up to, and that should be approximately, I missed that because it imports approximately as W. Don't ask me why. And I fixed one or two of those, but not this one. So the early work said it ended at about 150. Now we're saying it's more like 200, more or less. Can you be that precise? Well, a pilot uranium thorium speleothem dating project for the Kesem Cave using thermal ionization mass spectrometry yielded 8 ages and indicated a general range between 380 and 200 kiloyears ago, according to Barkai et al. To improve this chronology of Kesem Cave and to add to the general framework of the late lower Paleolithic in the Levant, we sampled speleothem material for multi-collector inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometers. Whoa, what a mouthful. Uranium-thorium dating. Apparently, they have improved the technique somewhat. The problem is that if you heat this stuff up and you get uranium ions and thorium ions that you can use in a mass spectrometer or measure in a mass spectrometer, that you have to be assured that you're not just getting half of the thorium and all of the uranium or something like that. Otherwise, your data is all completely off.
My question is, do they have a good control that the speleothem is younger than when the humans were in there?
Well, the claim that is made is that the speleothem is on the walls of the cave. It's actually flowstone. We'll see a picture of some of it. And that some of the speleothem layers come up to where the human remains and where the animal remains are at one level, and then some of it go over that, and if it goes over that, then obviously it's younger. So that's, now, is it that clear? Well, it depends on who you ask. I would kind of tentatively accept it, but I'd be a little bit cautious about making a full commitment there. Anyway, it's a uranium-thorium dating from a wider range of settings at Kesem Cave. And that should be a dash. Some within archaeological sediments and some in clear stratigraphic correlation with archaeological horizons. So, you know, sometimes you can tell for sure, and sometimes you can kind of, you think you can tell. Skipping on, Kesem Cave had been breached by natural erosion, which allowed entry of hominins and dissociated deposition. So Kesem Cave was already open. Kafr Kesem Cave has been breached only by recent road cutting. Remember 16 years ago when they blasted that limestone thing and they found a cave underneath it? According to this article, it's Kafr Kesem Cave, which Kafr Kesem is the name of the village nearby, and it just means magic village. Well, you'd say village magic in there if you're translating it literally, but and that this is weird, considering what the first article or what the original article that we read said. Since Kafr Kesem Cave still exists as an underground void with active natural cave processes, it was used as a model for reconstructing the history of Kesem Cave. Now, if you're going, that doesn't make sense with the beginning, you're right. And the craziest part is that I went and looked all over for Kafr Kesem Cave, and I can't find anybody else who writes about Kafr Kesem Cave. The people who did the speleothem obviously have been in it because they've cut out pieces of it to do research. So they should know which cave they're talking about. I will just have to leave that because when I did a Google search of Kafr Kesem Cave, I couldn't find anything. I could find Kafr Kesem and I could find Kesem Cave, but I couldn't find any Kafr Kesem Cave. So they're supposed to be like 90 meters away from each other or something like that. Okay? So it's like 100 yards, more or less. But nobody else talks about that. And it's weird because if you're trying to understand what's going on, you're left with some questions. Some people who apparently know the situation will say that there's two caves. Nobody else will say there's two caves. And I don't know who to believe on that. Skipping on down, an additional possible source of contamination considered in dating the Kesem Cave speleothem samples is uranium transfer from dissolution of bone and teeth with very high uranium content, up to 100 parts per million, in direct contact or close to the dated samples. If this was the case, additional uranium would give rise to open system behavior. What are we talking about, open system behavior? Well, the idea is that if you're going to date something, then you have to have a starting point where you know the starting part of the daughter, and you have to know the starting part of the parent. And then at that point, you have to close everything so nothing leaks in and nothing leaks out. If you get parent that leaks in, then it looks too young. If you get daughter that leaks in, it looks too old. If you get parent that leaks in, that leaks out, then you get too old. If you get daughter that leaks out, it looks too young. And the mathematics are horribly complex, and nobody wants to even think about dealing with them. And so what you really want is you want stuff that is closed. But apparently if you have human remains next to this stuff, it's open all the time. What does that mean? Well, it means it's probably open all the time, period. And it's just that you can show it a little bit easier if there are human bones with lots of uranium in them. You never thought of our bones as having lots of uranium, did you? Yes, just a minute. Go ahead.
A lot of people that live in very northern eastern Washington and northern Idaho have very high levels of uranium, lead, cadmium, mercury, a lot of different minerals because of the, what would it be? I guess it would be the granite rocks that are below them. And they have difficulty because they have to filter their water. So definitely this can happen.
Yeah. Well, apparently uranium can substitute for calcium. And so it actually gets incorporated into the bone structure.
I would add to this that we need to keep in mind that calcite is one of the most soluble and easily transportable minerals that there is. Our limestone caves are evidence of it.
That's why I got there in the first place. Is because it was soluble in water, and the water came down and evaporated and left some of the calcite there. So apparently open system behavior is possible. And apparently if you have human bones and teeth next to it, it's not only possible but common. So, if this was the case, addition of uranium would give rise to open system behavior and ages would not represent the real age of speleothem formation. Such contamination may be relevant to a series of 10 samples, all composed of low magnesium calcite. Okay. Q3, continuing on, 20 of 29 that have exceptionally high, I see the period doesn't actually end the sentence. I've broken one in half. So let's go back. It's not a period, it's a comma. Such contamination may be relevant to a series of 10 samples all composed of low magnesium calcite, Q3, that have exceptionally high uranium concentration. See below. Similar processes of contamination may also occur as a result of the presence of bat guano. One way to assess the influence of an open system on the reliability of the ages is to examine if the ages are in correct stratigraphic order. It helps. I mean, obviously, if they're going crazy all over the place, you could have... But I'm not sure that that's good enough to prove it. In this study, it is shown that the ages of speleothems with high uranium concentrations are not in stratigraphic order. Oh, okay, so some of them aren't in stratigraphic order, and they're clearly open system. But the other ones, well, let's look at some of this stuff. Here's our Q3 samples, and... first of all, I want to point out that this is in parts per million. So this is a very sensitive assay. Okay. Although they measure it to a quite small amount, down to 0.04. Now I don't know why this is 4.3 and not 4300. Or something like that. That's kind of an interesting point. And this is the uranium concentration, uranium-238. Now, uranium-234 is also found in the same area. I want you to notice that the activity, which means that this stuff has actually started out with more uranium-234 than uranium-238. Which shouldn't happen if you're importing pure uranium-238, but of course uranium-238 and 234 go at the same time. Well, it turns out the groundwater is relatively enriched today in uranium-234. So it's not that terribly surprising, although here's one that actually has a reverse where it has less 234 in terms of activity than it does 238. For what it's worth, uranium-234 decays faster than uranium-238. So when you're measuring them according to activity, you're actually The equal activity has much less uranium-234, in fact. And they have all these numbers here. And then there's a thorium-230 to 232. Well, let's go first, the 230 to 234, which is the one that they're actually measuring for thorium-H. Now, how this works is that uranium is soluble and thorium is not. And so the uranium goes with the calcium and gets deposited, but without any thorium whatsoever. Well, that's not actually true. Sometimes a little thorium comes with it, and so what they say is, well, the thorium must be pretty much the same as the for activity as the thorium-232, and so you should be able to subtract those out. Well, thorium-232 has no necessary relationship with thorium-230. So this is an attempt to fix a fudge factor with something that is not, we would call it in medicine, physiologic. It's not geologically connected, shall we say. Now, there's something that's even more interesting here as you go through these numbers. All of these numbers should be less than 1. If they are 1, then it's of effectively infinite H. Let's go. Well, actually, we can do that here, because here's this indeterminate 1. And it is 1.0373. You're not supposed to do that. Somehow, this one sample got more thorium in it to begin with than it had uranium. And it hasn't had time to decay away to 1. So thorium does move. How much, I don't know. It would be interesting to try to measure that. But the point of it is, you have to be really careful about that kind of measurement. And just saying that you like the dates is not really a good answer. And here's the corrected age, corrected for this detrimental thorium. 550, 550, 420. There's our 420. And you'll notice that here's a 510, 490. So apparently some of that stuff has been older than 400 years, 400,000 years. And then you keep going, and you'll see that it gradually goes down about 220. And we can't scroll down on this one, but I can go over to the next slide, which actually picks up at Q314. So some of that is duplicated. And you can continue to see how some of this goes all the way down to 186, 129, 189. And this is the stuff that's out of order. These should be all precisely in order, and they're not. So somehow they're getting contaminated. Well, that raises the whole question of whether all of it's getting contaminated and that there's some kind of systematic contamination that's giving you older to younger age without any relationship to time itself. Well, you see, if you believe that this is 200,000 years, then you go, yeah, I like this data, I like that data, and then you quit. If you're going, I'm not sure about this, should I be rearranging my entire belief system based on this kind of data, then I think it's fair to say, need a little more evidence. We have a comment here.
At the bottom of the page,
just a minute. We want to get this. Go ahead.
At the bottom of the page, you have a 42 and a 74. Suggesting 42,000 years and 74,000 years.
Yeah, well, these are different samples, though, to be fair. So they, yeah, but these are much younger. Now, what do you do with them? Well, they just don't fit. Maybe this is one next to a tooth, and this is what happens when you get human teeth. Anyway, Here's where they've taken out some of that flowstone, right there. And here is a sample where they say, oh, see, it all fits in this particular case. It goes from 510, 490, 425, 402, 390, and so forth, all the way. This is Q3 sample stuff. And then once you get up to here, well, this looks contaminated, so I can, you know, kind of buy that that one was contaminated. But this looks pretty good, and the numbers go pretty well, and so we like the numbers, so we'll believe them. Now, what about this other one? Well, this one has ESR U series, electron spin resonance. I didn't see a reference to thermoluminescence in the original article, although there's some here that imply that they did thermoluminescence as well. And again, this one can be found on ResearchGate, and so it's available to the general public. Qesem Cave is a middle Pleistocene site situated 12 kilometers east of Tel Aviv. It is attributed to the AYCC of the late Lower Paleolithic period, 420 to 200,000 years ago. This site exhibits a unique prehistoric sequence where the Amudian blade-dominated industry is the main cultural component. However, the scraper-dominated Yabrudian, which is, comes later, is also represented in distinct contexts at the cave. The chronology established by thermoluminescence, so there's, you know, somebody's done thermoluminescence, applied on burnt flits, ESRU series on herbivorous teeth, and U series on speleothem, suggests that Qesem Cave is one of the oldest sites yielding such a blade industry and a fully fledged trajectory of quinoa scrapers production. This work presents new ESRU. So all that stuff has already been established in the peer-reviewed literature. This work presents new ESRU dates, series dates on four animal teeth unearthed by from an Amudian central hearth recently published, and four other teeth from a Yabrudian industry bearing layer on the shelf. The dates range from 249 to 296 for the Amudian hearth. There's an extra different one to learn. And 279 to 382 for the Yabrudian layer. Mean age of 313. These radiometric dates provide new information on the chronology of the Amudian and Yabrudian industries in the hearth and shelf areas and contribute toward a better understanding of the chronology of Qesem Cave as a whole. This is the first time we have direct dates from Amudian and Yabrudian context from a single site. So, and I won't go through the whole thing, but in fact we'll kind of look at, but here's their dates and some other people's dates that they show. And you can see there's a fair correlation, although, you know, there's two of them on Mercier et al. This is their data, and this is the actual, well, this is closer to the actual data. And you can see that there's two of them that, there's three of them that can kind of be fitted together, and the rest of them kind of belong together, although it seems like if I were drawing a line, I would draw it about here. But yeah, they're giving you a spread, and they're giving you a two-humped spread. So this one is a little less than 300 kiloyears ago, and this one is a little less than 400 kiloyears ago. Okay, here's a table of what they have. It's a long table, so I've split it into two slides. But basically, they've measured stuff with enamel and with dentin, and cementum, but I don't see any of that in the slide at all. And again, they're measuring uranium. They're measuring 234 to 238 activity ratio. They're measuring 230 thorium to 234 uranium activity ratio, and you should be able to get a date out of that if the assumptions are correct, that thorium doesn't move and therefore doesn't get into this until it decays away. And then there's something odd, 220 radon to 230 thorium. That's not in the normal measurement stuff. What does that show? Well, probably what it shows is that the enamel keeps all its radon, and the dentin tends to leak out radon. That's what I'm guessing. Now, something odd, there's a species between those two. It is radium. And although I think if you do the spectroscopy, you'll probably be able to get radium at the same time, it's not clear quite why nobody's measuring radium ages. And the reason that's interesting is because radium ages actually probably could go back to 4,000 years. But nobody's really interested in what kind of data you're going to get. Or at least whoever's interested either didn't get grant money or wasn't able to publish, one of the two. Yes?
Could the fact that it's a gas be a serious problem? I mean...
Well, you think.
That's why they don't use it, I think.
Well, radium, though, is not a gas. But, of course, radium is soluble. Radium is in the same column as calcium. And so it would be very interesting to see how that worked out. This thing is strange because it says it has GY, which is billion years, and I'm not sure why that is in that column. But you can see that if it were kilo years, you would have a pretty decent set of dates. Other than that, there are no dates on that. Now, this raises the question, how reliable are those dates on recent material? And it's very difficult to find that answer. That is to say, it would be interesting to see stuff that we saw deposited 25 years ago and measure the uranium-thorium ratios there. And the only article that I've been able to see that does that is actually a rather old one. And maybe that's why, is because once you publish it, nobody really goes back to it. You can't get grant money to redo an old study. But this is Guy and Hennig, multiple dating of a long flowstone profile, done in a fairly reputable journal, Radiocarbon, and available on the internet. You have to do it in two stages. You have to go through Google Scholar, and then you have to click it, and it will download as a PDF. But here's a table that I wanted to show you. This is conventional carbon-14 age, uranium-thorium age, with presumably all those corrections in it, ESR age, that's the electron spin resonance, which is related to thermoluminescence and I've forgotten what the other one is that go together. And this is the activation dose, I believe it is. It's just how much radiation is coming from the thing. And here's the interesting thing. Here's a 3,000s by radiocarbon, which I kind of sort of accept. This is before present. So this is like 1,000 BC. 1135 or so. And this is 35. And now you start getting into areas that I think are probably distorted carbon-14. But 3.1, not bad for uranium-thorium. 3.7, 7.3. Oh, well, we've got a little discrepancy there. Got a little discrepancy there, a little younger. And now it starts to take off, and now we have, instead of 9,000, we have 13,000. Here's 11,000, 20,000, 13,092. Ooh, well, not exactly the same, is it? What's even more interesting is that although they didn't measure the 3135 by ESR, they did measure it by for the 3,500-year-old. That's 1500 BC. That's about the time of Moses. This was good, but this one is 43 to 72, depending on where you measure it. If you're not getting zero, that's a little difficult to find out. Now, some of you are probably wondering, what is ESR anyway? Well, ESR is electron spin resonance, and the idea is that there are crystals that have defects. And if you hit something near the defect with an ionizing radiation, you can actually get something to jump into that hole and stay there, an electron. And then if you heat it up, it will put out photons, a photon, as it jumps back to where it belongs. And if you, that's thermoluminescence. You heat it up, and it becomes luminescent. If you put it in a magnetic field, you can measure the spin flip of it when you hit it with radio waves. So basically the same idea as MRI, or yeah, those of you who've had that done on your bodies will kind of understand kind of the process. And the advantage of that is that you leave it right there and you can measure it. But how do you know how much radiation there was, how many of these things there are, how much energy it takes to flip it in? It is not what you would call secure dating. It's physical, but it's not really radiometric. Okay, and it looks like stuff that's 3,000 years old. You're getting 43 to 72. Be interesting to see what you get the stuff that's 15 years old. And if you start out that high, well, you kind of get a gradation. And see, now that you're out at 300 or 208, you can do what you want to with that. Now, I'm a little concerned with people who start out knowing what it's supposed to be and then get the right dates. That's not the way we do it in medicine. You send off for the potassium and it comes back and they don't ask you, well, is this patient in renal failure? The whole point is you want to know whether they are in renal failure. That's why you're sending this stuff out. So my take on all this is you have to decide how much trust to put in uranium-thorium disequilibrium dating. How much trust to put in thermoluminescence dating and electron spin resonance dating, which have problems. They do kind of fit. How much of that is cherry picking? How much of that is actually works? If you're trained to be a skeptic, you kind of start with a little bit of skepticism. The other thing that I think that can be said is it looks like Homo species all have used tools. And that's not something that you would have figured out from the popular spiel that gets out. Another point that's interesting is bone and rock last longer than wood and especially grass. So if somebody made a grass rope, which you could, you know, some kind of fibrous tissue and you rubbed it and then you made some really nice cloth, it wouldn't necessarily show up with this stuff. It could be all decayed or eaten or whatever away. I have my doubts that these people actually only use stone tools. It's just that that's what's lasted. Early humans are likely to have pressed any handy material into service for whatever they wanted. The fact that we can show that bone scrapers are used doesn't mean that they didn't use wood. It may simply mean that they reused it till it fell apart and then it got left outside of the or decayed away, and so all we have is the bone, and the flint tools. Perhaps the most interesting observation that can be made is there seems to be a scarcity of human remains in the cave. So they're either burying their dead outside, or they're all dying outside, which is possible but not likely, or something else. But I want to put some numbers to that. By standard estimates, people lived there for 100,000 to 200,000 years, depending on whose dates you believe, right? Okay. Let's call it 100,000. Assume that on average there was a family of four living there at all times. Because if you don't have that, you don't have kids to keep going, right? So that's an absolute minimum estimate, unless these people live part of the time there and part of the time somewhere else. Okay? Assume that the average generation time is 25 years. Okay? That leaves 16 people dying per century. They have to go somewhere. Or for 100,000 years, that's 16,000 people. And you have a cave with maybe 10 teeth. Oh, let's say we haven't found them all. So maybe there's 50 or 100 teeth. Is that a viable proposal? Is there evidence for 16,000 people living in the cave? Or 8,000 or 5,000? Where are the skeletons? More importantly, because maybe they buried their dead somewhere else, where are the animal bones to feed them? Because I don't think that they really cared that much about whether the animal bones fell down and then, you know, sunk into the mud and whatever. And some of them did. But enough to feed 16,000 people for 100,000 years? Something is wrong. And the question is, could the time have been exaggerated? Sometimes I think we need to ask questions that are off the beaten path, because they won't be asked by anybody else. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. A couple of comments here. Let's see. We'll take here and then Jan. Okay, go ahead.
Those who believe in the Bible, of course, my understanding, I don't believe in this thing of Neanderthal and Homo erectus and all, because this is evolution. And we know that from the beginning, man was created perfect. He used tools from the very, very, very beginning. So I know you're trying to analyze this article.
Right.
And find the...
Well, if you want to go biblical, you know that by the time of Tubal Cain, we had metal working.
Yeah.
And that's before the flood, which means it's certainly before a conservative biblical approach on this.
So they're really reaching. I mean, they're out in a totally make-believe magic land, as far as I'm concerned.
Just call it Kesem.
Yeah, right.
A comment, yes?
Just one little question. What's the chance of carbon-14 dating that bone?
Well, it's actually should be pretty easy. The thing of it is, everybody knows that it's 300,000 years old, so why would you do that? Because it will be beyond the age limit.
Yeah, but that's kind of breaking down a little bit, isn't it? Because all these dinosaurs, they have carbon-14 in them. And...
Well, yeah, but see, that's only creationists who do that. You know, that data is no good. You know, if the funding source were funding conservative... Christians, I think that that's one of the things that would happen in those kind of situations, is that we would get some carbon-14, especially now that we have accelerator mass spectrometry and you don't have to destroy the whole bone to date it.
could there be enough tissue there, enough carbon there to do it? It's another question.
Oh, sure. Sure, bone dating can be done anytime. Now, of course, the big objection will be, well, but it's such a small amount and they're so easy to contaminate and you won't get any, you know, if you did get something, it would be invalid. Of course, that argument could be used to say that, well, but people did dinosaur bone dating and it came out with all, with much younger ages than we expected and above the limitation. So when you are a program director, what you do is you say, those ages just can't be right. And so you really shouldn't, we should not have let you present that thing in our meeting. And so we will just make it go away. That's called the missing presentation. Wait a minute, Jan.
This may seem like an oversimplification, but the word trust comes back to me, and I saw it up there several times today. If I don't feel well, I go to my doctor because I know he knows more than I do, and that's why I go.
Right.
People in a busy lifestyle, which is society today, haven't studied this. So they read something like this, and they feel, well, they know, they study it. I haven't studied it. So the bottom line is, if you don't have a biblical backdrop, you can't say, I'm going to trust God rather than man.
It's kind of
a bottom line. Moving people in whatever way we can to give God's word a chance seems to be the only chance of...
No.
I mean, trust, both sides are trusting.
You're absolutely right. Both sides
both
are trusting.
Require trust.
And the real question is, who deserves your trust more? And that's a really tough call to make. And I guess, you know, you have to look at what data you do have. It's helpful, at least to me, to be able to go back and say, well, I don't have to trust. I can ask them what their original data was and think about it myself. If you don't, you're basically going to have to decide, is this good enough to change my view of, or to create my view of history and of religion and of everything. I guess one of the things I'm trying to say is that you don't necessarily have to be, you don't have to swallow it whole, or otherwise you're a bad person or not a scientist or some other, you don't know what you're talking about. Well, the fact of the matter is none of us know completely what we're talking about. That guy in Hennig article at the end that showed that ESR was, you know, 10 times too high at the very beginning. As far as I can tell, I haven't thoroughly searched all of the literature, but as far as I can tell, it appears that that is the only study where they actually did something where I can sink my teeth into it. And it looks like you shouldn't. You're going to bite a stone if you do that. A couple of comments over here.
I remember they dated Mount St. Helens, and they discovered that Mount St. Helens actually exploded 1.5 million years ago.
I do know that there are some dates in that general range. I don't remember them exactly, but the point of it is that you start out with an actual age that does not fit from recent. And, you know, if I'm trusting a method, it needs to work on zero age material. If I am trying a new method of measuring potassium in the laboratory, And I put purified sodium chloride into it, and I get an amount of, 3 milliequivalents per liter. That's not a method I'm going to trust.
The St. Gabriel reservoir, they clean them and they have 20 million cubic yards of debris. I hear that these mountains had been here for about 300 million years.
It depends on who's talking. I think the more common one is to say it's between 90 and 150, but yeah, it's a general range.
Okay. My question is, if they have 20 million cubic yards of debris on about 60 years, can those mountains gain whole erosion that many millions of years?
Well, actually, we have an expert in the field.
Average rate of all the continents of the world, based on 12 different comprehensive studies, is 61 millimeters per 1,000 years, or we could say 61 meters per million years. Our continents should have been washed out a long time ago. This is a severe challenge to radiometric dates, not by a single study, but by many studies, well-accepted figure. And when this came to light about 50 years ago, in the geologic literature, several commented, how come we're still here? Our whole topography should have disappeared in 10 million years. Not figure 10 million years, which is, based on that figure I gave you. But we're still here.
Well, what's worse is, how come we still have layers? Because the top layers should go first.
Top layers should go first, and so on, and the whole column is still there. It should have been washed away a long, long time ago. The story is, of course, mountains are renewed. This is in the literature. The reason we still have mountains now is because it's renewed from below. Mountains keep building up. Well, you could have destroyed your column 100 times at least. I'm being conservative. The figure's more like 200, 230, I think. But you could have destroyed your mountains at least 100 times in geologic time, and they're still here. I mean, your column, and it's still there. There's something askew.
And the worst part of it is there are mountains that have the Paleozoic still on top of them.
Like Mount Everest.
Like Mount Everest, like the Alps. I mean, it's not just Mount Everest. It's a relatively common phenomenon. I mean, if you go to the Rocky Mountains, the top of them are granite. So that could have come up from below. But if you go to some other mountains, it's not. And that should have been gone a long, long time ago. Well, this is the same kind of problem that we're talking about. If there have been humans for 100 million years, if you start doing the numbers, there should be human bones all over everywhere, especially in caves where they lived, and there should have been the trash that they put out. And it raises the question, maybe the time factors are exaggerated, but if that's the case, then somebody came to the cave, lived a few years, left, came to the cave, lived a few years, left, came to the cave, lived a few years, and left. And so it was only there for maybe 1/1000th of the time, or 1/10000th of the time.
Well, on that note, maybe we should have a bone layer 30 feet deep around the entire Earth.
Well, I mean, of course, and then you say, but it's been eroded away. somehow it's just not working well. Now, before I get any further, we have somebody who we kind of talked over. I want to give her a chance. Go ahead.
My question was, where did all these people go? How it seems so wild.
Well,
my imagination doesn't quite reach that.
You know, if you think about it, I think there's a problem there. And one of the kind of obvious solutions is that it wasn't that much time, and so it was a little bit easier. But, of course, that's not a solution that is, shall we say, currently popular in academia.
So what is the Geoscience Institute doing to...
Well, the Geoscience Institute hasn't talked about this yet.
Oh.
This just came out
that's
in November,
something for them
and they're
to
busy.
Do.
They're busy with other projects. And by the way, the Geoscience Research Institute funding for actual research is considerably less than average, and so it's not terribly surprising that you don't get published with this kind of stuff. That, and of course, the publish and perish phenomenon. Go ahead and see. Pass that back over. Go ahead, Eduardo.
Probably is a question out of the issue, but I have this question. Can anybody measure the glaciers and get an estimate of, excuse me, how much water they contain, and how much they can raise the sea level, because I am pretty much a skeptic about this, the global warming going on.
Well, I would say actually there's some good evidence for global warming during the Middle Ages. It had probably deleterious effects in some areas and some salutary effects in other areas. The Vikings managed to make it to the New World probably partly because of that, a little bit more open sea.
But my question is the sea level.
The sea level.
How much water the glaciers contain?
Well, if you were to, okay, no, most people will say Antarctica is not going to really melt. And because of the way it's situated, if it does, it probably won't make that much difference. But if Greenland were to melt, there would be quite a bit of elevation of global sea level. It would be inconvenient, to say the least. New York City would probably have to either become like the Netherlands with the pumps and everything, or would have to give up and move out of there. And the Everglades would probably turn back to shallow ocean. And you'd probably have a few islands in South Florida. That would be the downside. There would be an upside elsewhere, but most people want to keep things more or less the way they are, so it's not unreasonable to say, well, we really don't want global warming. But that's a whole different subject, and I really don't want to get into it today. Maybe another day we'll take a look at the fundamentals of it. But let's just say, in global warming, I would say you have to be a little bit careful about the published reports. You know, don't take the press releases at face value. Don't take the press releases for anything at face value. And if there is, let's say, important political consequences or important cultural consequences, that's all the more reason to be extra careful about it. Because what it suggests is that if it favors one side, that side is not going to be very critical of of the research. And that's just natural, because it gives the right answers, so it's probably good, even though, as you've seen, there's some data that suggests that, for example, thorium is mobile somehow. We don't know how, we don't know how much, but somehow it gets in there. And so you have to be just... you're going to have to weigh all the different sources, and you're going to have to ask yourself which ones are more reliable. And short of that, I would urge you not to make major changes in your worldview just based on a few pieces of data here and there. I can tell you that I've had people deliberately give me a cherry-picked piece of data, which when I read the literature turns out to be not really valid. And if I had just thrown up my hands and said, you can't do that, I'll have to quit, then I would have quit for no good reason. You do not take anything 100% until you have several different ways of checking it, and they all match, and it matches your personal experience. And even if you do take it with, unless you've personally seen it, take it with a certain skepticism that says that you could reverse yourself later. I think that's true if one is on the other side, too. I think that creationist literature should be taken with a certain skepticism as well. That until it's been repeated a few times and until it actually fits, then you want to be... You can believe it, but you don't... You kind of... don't put all of your eggs in that basket.
Can you do some research? Because I wanted to take this issue scientifically with mathematics. How many gallons the glaciers contain? How much sea space do we have? And then make the mathematics and come up with a number.
That can be done. And all you have to do is to find out the elevation of Greenland above sea level, the height of the snow, and the extent of Greenland, all of which are relatively straightforward to measure, and then multiply it out. I'm sorry? The ice has pressed some of the center down so that when the ice is released, the center will come up a little bit, too. That's an additional factor that you have to take into account. But even if you were to just melt it down in the center, let's say part of the center is below sea level, and you just left that in, that will still give you a minimum case. I mean, I think it's fair to say that if Greenland were to melt, then you would expect the sea level to go up. I think it's also interesting to see that within apparent human lifetimes, the sea level has been much lower than it is now, because there are caves that are now flooded that have human remains below the water, and you can show old drowned harbors. So the sea level actually has risen already, and if you're living in New York, you really don't like that. If you're living in the Netherlands, you really don't like that, because now your dikes have to be however much higher, or else you have to abandon the land. But it's an interesting thing. But I suggest that whenever you do something like that, you again be careful with it, and trust it as much as you can actually do the math yourself. For as far as the mathematical end of it, mm-hmm. Reagan said, trust but verify, and that's probably a good piece of advice.
Paul?
Yes? Yeah.
I wanted to get back to Nancy's question, because I think it's a valid question that needs to be asked about the human population and its growth rate. We all know that our population is increasing very rapidly. Our figures vary, you know, from 30 to 100 years, and we double our population. And you take those figures and you go backwards. And you go back in just a few thousand years, you get to two people.
Maybe eight, but yeah.
I was going a little back, further back than that, but then it's okay. Eight is also in the equation.
If everybody else was wiped out, then you age
three
start. Fully.
But the question is, compare that rate with the rate we have for the rare cases, and we are finding more and more of them, of human remains. But they're hard to find. And we're talking about 200,000 years. We're talking about 400,000 years. The scarcity doesn't seem to fit with the rate of human population growth on an average. I think it's a legitimate question to raise. Was man around that long? Why didn't the earth fill up a long time ago when you consider how rapidly the earth is, our increase is at present?
Well, I think there's another related question, and that is that we have evidence for Neanderthals burying their dead that go back 30, 40,000 years at least. And I don't know how far back we can document that, but it goes back a ways.
It's usually stated, agriculture did not develop. And therefore, man could not get enough food, so he didn't reproduce that rapidly, and so on. This is one of the excuses given. In general, I believe anthropologists feel that agriculture was developed as a necessity, not as just a haphazard thought.
Well, let's say that everybody's been burying their dead for, I don't know, pick a number, 50,000 years. How many people, how many graves should you find during that period of time with a population that's sustainable in various places? And I'm not sure that there are enough graves to really do the job.
Those numbers disagree with present rate of growth of the human population. Just starting with two anytime along the way.
Right. Yes.
There's an ancient map that shows the area between England and Holland at one time was above land. And so Holland extended much further out into the sea. And they have evidence of habitations that have now been covered by the seawater. And there's also some islands out in the Caribbean where they have built, the populace built a dike around their city and kept raising the dike wall as the water rose. And finally, those walls are some 30 to 40 feet high, and those walls are now underwater as well when the water finally flooded over the top of the wall.
I think that, I don't know personally that I've seen those reports, but it certainly sounds reasonable. And that's what people are afraid of, is going to happen to the Netherlands.
I've seen the photographs. I've seen the underwater photographs of these findings. It's fascinating because it's a complete town. Yeah. You know, all the ruins of the town walls, everything there, and this wall, this dike surrounding it, and it's all underwater now. These fellows who do the underwater diving go down and dive around in it.
What I do know is that the English Channel has evidences.
How long ago did this happen?
We don't know. No one's done archaeology on it.
Okay.
See, now there's some place that you can spend some grant money. It's interesting that there is good evidence that's been in the published literature now from ultrasound soundings and stuff like that, that the English Channel at one time was dry and had a flood actually carve it out in much the same way as the floods in Montana, Idaho, Washington State. And, I mean, they can show sandbar kind of things and braided channels and stuff like that in the bottom of the English Channel. And that's been now known for, I don't know, probably several years now. It'd be interesting for somebody to go and collect where you can find that all over the world and, show what's going on. I think that it will be interesting to see. Well, science is a long ways to go to have gotten everything nailed down. And there's plenty of places to spend grant money. Would you like to say anything?
The usual dates given for the flooding of the English Channel would be 5,000 to 8,000 years ago at the end of the last ice age, as the ice melted. And yes, there's a very famous cave, the entrance to which is about 150 feet underwater. It's thought that the water level came up about 300 feet, but there is a cave in which the entrance is now 150 feet underwater. And the cave itself has paintings of human hands on its walls, so there's no question that humans got into it. There's no entrances ever found on land, so it's assumed people got in there when the English Channel was dry. We have French friends, and I was explaining this to them one day, and I said you could walk from Paris to London on dry land. And their response was, who would want to do that?
go ahead. Okay. Yeah, let's not leave you out. Just a minute. Let's pass the... Just a minute. Go ahead.
About the death and how many people were buried through the years, is that taking into account that people back then lived so many more years, so there would be less people dying? I don't know if that's a factor to consider.
Well, it could be a factor, but there's one thing to consider. That's not, standard history. and so people who are, people who are trying to explain Kesem Cave can't fairly use that explanation. And besides that, it doesn't work for the animals. It might work for the people, but they got to eat.
Just wanted to make this comment. When you're putting all those tables up and comparing the dates by different methods, it seemed to be a suggestion, and it wasn't complete, but that the error got greater as you went down the list.
Which is getting older.
Getting older. And this raises the question of systematic errors or systematic discrepancies, which immediately you ask why and can tell you, hey, there's some alternative explanations here. But we haven't found them yet, but at least the data suggests there's something to be looked at here.
Yeah, well, for example, if thorium has 1/100th the solubility of uranium, then thorium would be moving too, as well as uranium, and all of a sudden that whole paradigm falls flat on its face because you don't know what the original thorium was. You can't assume it was zero. And in fact, there's some interesting arguments that can be made. I argued that we should do some looking at coral from before the flood.
Paul, sea level can be local?
No, not really.
So
that's the one of the things about sea level. Now, you could have a lake level that would be higher than sea level, but the sea can distribute itself all around the world, and so it's sea level is sea level pretty much, period. I think there's a slight problem with the rotation of the Earth's axis, and so the Panama Canal, I think the Pacific is higher than the Atlantic by like 2 or 3 feet or something like that, but that's about as bad as you get.
So it's probability that some land might be sinking and...
Yeah, well, or that there's an awful lot of water that was once in the Canadian Shield and over Europe that was doing what Greenland is doing today, locking up water above the above the sea level. That's what most people will say, is it was the Ice Age or one of the Ice Ages, or, you know, depending on how many you have. If you have four of them, which I think is traditional, then it happened four times. If it was just one of them, then...
The church right now has Winter Wednesdays, and I wondered if you would be open, you and maybe some friends of yours, if I put in a word for a future Winter Wednesday. Have you ever done a series of meetings such as that?
If they're interested enough, why, I suppose that I would see what I could do. We certainly have enough material to... keep people busy for a while.
And something that those of us who don't have the backdrop of all the technical, something that I wish there were more of my own colleagues who could hear some of this and spark an interest, because we're teaching children. I stopped getting the weekly reader because it's indoctrinating children to feel badly for polar bears and badly for the monkeys in South America, and children are coming up with ideas through their little children newspapers about sea levels and global warming, things that are...
And by the way,
not accurate.
That's intentional, by the way.
Oh, absolutely. So I get Creation Magazine, but years ago I stopped getting the Weekly Reader and other type magazines. But most of our public schools, it's happening to elementary children. It's happening before they ever get to high school and they see, you know, this is the soup and this is that, and then we've got the ape and then we've got humans. And
well, there is so much to do. Now, I will tell you that I have been invited again, I guess they liked the last time, to talk at St. George, Utah, to a bunch of American educators of various times, mostly college, I think. I'm trying to find out exactly what the audience is, because I need to tailor my talk to, you know, what level I'm dealing with. And interestingly enough, shortly thereafter, in Montemorelos, Mexico. So the church is trying slowly to get this kind of stuff out. There'll be a whole bunch of other people that are going with me, by the way, and they're getting non-Adventists to participate in the process, because they realize that the creationist community and the Adventist community are not identical. Mm-hmm. And some people are really experts at that kind of thing, and so I know that they've got John Baumgartner, for example, scheduled, and Marcus Ross, I think, and a few other people like that. Pardon me? I think, in fact, I think Kurt is talking just before me. And so it's going to be, we're trying to get it to, you know, educators, and hopefully from there it will filter down. And I'm going to be trying, let's see how whether I can get this done, but I'm going to be trying to get a paper so that when they walk out, they not only get to hear the talk so it makes sense, but also the paper so that it, so that they have something they can walk home with and look it up for themselves and have their kids look it up. You know, I'm a firm believer in the Adventist way of doing theology, which is you don't take anybody's word for it, you go back and look yourself. Well, I think we should be doing the same thing in science. Yes.
Yeah, I have a question that's kind of been bothering me about a video that I saw in reference to kind of like a nuclear war that allegedly had taken place many, many years ago. India is coming up with data on archaeological evidence of masses of people being killed with nuclear potential. And it brings about a bunch of questions, like there may not be an ice age involved in this one.
Well, I would say two things. Number one, if you're looking at the literature, again, be careful, be skeptical. They need to prove their point. But let's jump one step beyond that, which we don't know whether we need to yet or not. The Bible records that the imagination of man's heart was only evil continually. Ellen White implies that the people back then were incredibly brilliant, and because they lived a long time, they didn't have to have the internet because they remembered their own experiments and they talked to other people who had experiments.
No, I've seen some.
And so it is possible. I don't want to say likely yet, but it is possible that people had figured out one way or another, maybe by theory, maybe by experiment, maybe by a combination, that if you, you know, took uranium and processed it in certain ways, you could make a nuclear explosion. And it is possible that one of the reasons for the flood was because we had just gotten so bad that we were willing to use every means possible, including nuclear.
Right. Now, these skeletons that were left to be seen, spectacles, lots of skeletons strewn in a particular way, as if a wave had hit them and they died right there on the spot.
Yeah.
And the radiation levels in this particular area were very, very high.
Now, there are a couple of things. You know, one of them is that if people were actually able to do that, it is possible also that people who lived through that time would know enough about it that they could redo it after the flood. Now, I'm not saying that that happened. I'm still skeptical enough that I need a little more proof, because what happens is that people get ideas and they take it and run with it. And I'll just give you an example of an idea that people have taken and run with. There are people who show some videos of Michelle Obama and try to argue that she's really a transvestite man. And I suppose which means that Obama is homosexual and, you know. And, okay, the videos kind of look interesting at one point, but you know what? She has two kids. It's if we have witnesses to a pregnancy, it's going to be pretty hard to make her into a man. It really is. So, you know, if you have people who give you only the information they want, whether they be evolutionists, even whether they be creationists, whether they be people who, let's say, are trying to demonstrate that Michelle Obama is really a man. You need to have a little more evidence than a couple of shots in a video.
Right, I guess time will tell on that one.
Yeah. So, you know, the scientific attitude is skepticism. Don't forget that. If anybody tells you something that's scientific, you have a right to be skeptical. You have a right to ask for evidence. You have a right to say, you have a right to be from Missouri. Show me.
It's responsible. It's the responsible.
It's the responsible thing. Yes, you're exactly right.
Paul, over here. Why the Department of Education let those things go into the curriculum?
They're trying not to. They're creating a brand new set of science textbooks that are based on creationist ideas. I don't know how fast that's going to happen. I know that it's partly there already.
We've been using it
which,
for 3 years.
So it's it they're
which
actually. I think North American Division.
Oh, okay. But we've always had. I've been teaching for 2 years, so we've always had our own science books. It's the public schools that don't have.
That's true, but even I mean.
All my science when, books have always been creation.
Yeah. When I took world history in college, I remember we had a textbook, a main textbook, and we started in chapter 3. And me being interested in those kinds of things, I read chapters 1 and 2. And there were two conclusions I drew. One of them is that they don't fit with classical Adventism. Number two is they ran smoothly into chapter 3. And what that told me was somewhere there's a break, and as far as I could tell, we hadn't identified where that was. So there's a lot of work in history to be done. There, I mean, there's all kinds of stuff that needs to be done. And we're working on it, and actually our textbooks that we have now are supposed to be much better than what we used to, and just from what I know, I think they are.
However, our social studies that's coming out next year is not creation-based, and I've asked about that, and that's in the general.
Well, I think that we'll find out that creationism will pervades all of. I mean, just to give an example, if Adam and Eve is the original creation story, then it has certain implications for example, homosexuality. It's not normal. Now, you can. There's a whole different question is what you should do about it, but certainly it's not normal. On the other hand, if we're just animals and you can show that some animals do it, well, what difference does it make? And so, yes, there is all kinds of stuff where the creationist outlook influences stuff that you wouldn't think about ordinarily.
Yes. It's a matter of money. The North American Division didn't have the money to create, hire people to create our own social studies first grade through 12. So we are going to be going with one of two companies, I'm not sure which. And we'll have to, when we get to those units, I mean, I want my students to hear what's being presented up the street at Bryn Mawr Elementary School.
Yeah.
I want them to know. I don't want them to get out of school and then feel
then
like they've been duped.
Blindsided. Why didn't
exactly.
they tell me this?
Right. Exactly. And so they're 10 years old, and I want them to hear it. Many of them haven't from their parents. I'm the first voice there that they're hearing. So
and some of them have heard it only the other way, and now they're coming to you, and you're having
yes.
to give them the a little more conservative
mm-hmm.
Viewpoint.
Mm-hmm.
But that means that you're having to answer their questions.
Right. So Barnes & Noble has helped me. I've gone and gotten several children's books on evolution And I have them out so the children can turn the pages and go, oh, wow. And they can see both.
Well, it'll be interesting to see what happens. I have to say, I am glad that we're at least starting to work on it. It sounds like there's still a lot of work to do. And so that's going to keep people busy for a long time, I think. Yeah. But as you can see, just one article can keep you busy for several hours, and that's if you know where to look for various things. Like the guy in Hennig, I couldn't trace back from that. I had to go back from my own experience because I had run into this before. And by the way, how I ran into it, I'll just say, and then maybe we should stop for today because but how I ran into it was Irv Taylor handed me a book which was supposed to convince me that the radiometric dating things were secure. And it had 76 different methods. Well, what happens is when you whittle those down, it turns out that there's, you know, probably only about 10 or 12 that are really relevant and that they feel are secure. And if you go back, you find out that some of the, there's some problems with them that they acknowledge but don't realize the implications of them, and some problems that they don't necessarily even acknowledge, the worst one being carbon-14, because they never looked at it from that angle. And this is one of the places where I wound up kind of stepping out further enough to where I really needed to start defending carbon-14 as a creationist project. But that will only happen if there are people who are willing to think outside of the box and are willing to work at it and take some time and eventually some money. And so we have our work cut out for us. But in the meantime, my strong argument would be don't throw away your faith on the basis of this kind of data, because it's not really secure enough to ruin your faith. It really isn't. One more comment here, and then I will...
Just wanted to mention they're working on a high school textbook for biology also.
Well, they have the elementary school already done.
It's all done, yes.
Yeah, and so now they're working on high school, and I suppose eventually they'll work on some kind of college thing. But
you mean they have not had one?
Oh, college is all
high school.
Old ones that have gone out of print a long time ago.
Booth, they have not really worked at it as much as they could.
That was 60 years ago.
This is a work in progress, and we can only hope and pray, and where people ask us to, we can try to help. But we'll see what happens. And anyway, next week we're going to talk about black holes and why there may not be any.